Welcome to the Jesus People segment of the Antioch Indie Podcast, a place where each week we're going to hear from different people about what it means to walk with God. We hope that you leave encouraged and equipped and that this builds your faith for what God wants to do in your life. Welcome everybody to the Jesus People portion of Antioch Indie Podcast. I am here today with Andrew.
Is this a bonus episode?
This is a bonus episode.
Yes.
So we're trying to stick a little more series specific just for this month because this series is a little more dicey and maybe could produce more questions.
Mm. So I wonder if anybody started sweating yet.
I think you're the only one. You've referenced it both Sundays, and I think it's because you know what's ahead. Everyone else
right.
is like in it, you know?
Yeah,
just like, take
so.
Me wherever you want to go.
Totally. And then hey, if that's what people are thinking, then
right,
that's great.
They probably get more nervous as we go. This past week was Mother's Day, and you spoke on women.
Yes.
And I really appreciate that, obviously, being a woman and a mom. But one of the reasons I think that I wanted to hear what you were going to say is because I feel like there is so much chatter in the world right now about women.
Yeah.
Like the Me Too movement and just like all the things that have been coming up. And
yes.
whether a woman can be, like we just had our first woman run for president
mm-hmm.
and lots of voices on that. And it just feels like this is a buzzword issue.
Mm.
Like you just never know if you're going to offend somebody. You know what I'm
yeah.
talking about?
Yeah. Oh yeah. Oh, I do
and
know
like
what you're talking about.
It's like touchy and
yeah.
And so I personally love yeah. being a woman, have always loved it.
Never, you should.
Never in my life once wanted to be a man. Think y'all are gross. No offense. I mean, I think you're great. Just
great,
wouldn't want to be
gross.
A man. And I'm just so thankful to be a woman. But I think like the older I get, I obviously was like, grew up in a great home. So
yeah.
didn't have any kind of the harassment
right.
issues or anything that I think a lot of women genuinely experience, and I've never felt less than. I think I was parented in that way.
That's huge.
But I think that a lot of women, not a lot, but I do think that there is a lot of wounding that's gone on.
Yeah.
And men can be chauvinistic or mm-hmm. have a better than in all that kind of stuff. So there's
yeah.
this conversation swirling. So I was anticipating what you were going to say, and I thought it was wonderful.
Oh, good.
But I was frustrated.
Was it what you anticipated?
Yeah, I think you had great points, and I think what we're maybe sensing even from some of the questions on Instagram is people, you didn't give answers like in a right or wrong or this camp or this camp. And
mm-hmm.
that is always frustrating to people.
Totally.
To be left campless,
mm.
you know, or to be left without like a political party they're going to like
yeah.
now run for.
Right.
And is it like, is it pro women or are we like pro men or what are we? Cause I want to know.
Mm.
And so I feel like, I feel like you basically like left it where you just were acknowledging women's worth.
Yeah.
Which was great.
Right.
And women's worth in God's eyes.
Mm-hmm.
But I was telling you before.
What I think the message was, we're not pro women and we're not pro men.
It was like,
we're like pro people and God's creation and
yeah. Well,
God's
and I think I loved how you cultural architects, like what we're trying to do is establish the kingdom of God. So what was God's original intention?
Right.
When he like created a man first, and we can't argue with that. And then he made a woman.
Mm-hmm.
And then like, he speaks to both of them. He interacts with both of them. He curses both of them
mm-hmm.
after the fall. Like he holds them both accountable. It's not like the man was just held accountable and the woman was, you know?
Yeah.
So anyway, I like how we're coming around and just being like, what was God's original idea without sin
mm-hmm.
in the picture?
Yeah, right.
For women.
Yeah.
But
and
I was frustrated.
Yeah.
I felt like at the end of it, because you seemed to wrap it up. Like, what are these two women? What you said, what are two things that women bring to the table? And I realized where you were going and the context of your message, but I was like, are those the only two things that
right.
I bring to the table?
Right.
And you had a response for me.
Yeah. yeah. And I, as I was preparing, I knew that that would be a question that people would ask is like, oh, that's nice and everything, but great. So those are the only two things I can do.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing is, I never said anything about this being the only things that you can do.
I know, but I feel like that's like everyone's like
right.
antennas are up. Like, what can women do? What can women
totally.
Not do, especially in the church?
Right. Yes. Yeah. Especially in the church. And so, sorry that you thought that, you know, but no, but seriously, it's kind of like, you know, for, I know I'm sure that somebody walked out of the room and was like, oh, that was like another really kind, well-packaged patronizing way to tell women that all they can do is give hugs.
Mm-hmm.
Like I'm sure somebody walked around there and was like, oh, he
but
just
not,
talked
not
about
a frontal
how,
hug, just a side hug.
Right. Only side hugs.
Safe hugs.
Right.
We actually do think that's probably the best, but right.
It's so not
anyway,
the point
okay.
of what we're talking about. So the whole point was definitely not the only two things that women bring to the table are these two things. The point was, here are two things that women uniquely bring to the table among all of the things mm-hmm. that women in general bring to the table, both as women and just as people. So mm-hmm. women in general, or a woman in general, or specific, or whatever. So I think that's why it's a dicey issue, is that so many people have their radar up to assume that they're going to get limited, or someone's going to tell them things they can't do mm-hmm. or like where they aren't valuable, or the only things they bring to the table, or whatever. And so I think people come into conversations, really they're going to come into this series, you know, and pretty much any of the things we talk about, that radar is going to be up mm-hmm. for different people on different weeks in different ways, you know. Mm-hmm. And you know, I think there's different reasons for that. Part of that is going to be because people are coming in with hurt from real things. Mm-hmm. I think people are coming in from a cultural norm of offense, and like the world, talk about culture. I mean, yeah. It's like so cool to be offended. Yeah. And it's like the cool thing to do is to get mad at somebody.
Right.
And our culture is so polarized right now on who's right and who's wrong.
Right.
And that's just not the spectrum of the kingdom of God. Mm-hmm. It's what did God design, and are you following it or not? Mm-hmm. You know, it's which isn't even right or wrong. Like mm-hmm. there's so much liberation in God. And so I think we come to conversations with our guards up. We come to the Bible with our guards up. We come to God with our guard up. And therefore, we hear things into a message that aren't even there. Or we read things into the Bible that's not there. Or we hear things in a conversation that somebody didn't even say. Mm-hmm. So I think part of being able to have these conversations really well is like having, I think, humility and also trust
right.
with each other as we go through these different conversations, that like, you know, humility on the side of, okay, I'm coming into this with my own expectations, my own definitions of words,
my
own experience, my own lens, my own pain, mm-hmm. my own background, and all those things. And none of those things are inherently bad or good or worse or better. Like, it just is what it is. Mm-hmm. So I think we all have to be humble and understand, okay, you know, I'm bringing me to the table mm-hmm. and all that's included in. But then I think we also have to trust each other too, that we're, you know, if we're going to have a culture of honor, we have to be able to trust each other, that we're not trying to put each other in boxes and say, well, let's have this conversation. And the end goal of this conversation is to figure out who is stronger and who is weaker, mm-hmm. who is better, who is worse, who is able, who is not. And it's like such a low aim of a conversation or a culture or a life to be like, okay, let's figure out where I fit in the pecking order. Mm-hmm. Like, there's nothing kingdom about that, but there's everything culturally worldly about that. Like, that's what we're all fighting for. And so that's why I think it's hard to have these conversations, not because they're actually inherently hard, but it's hard because we have us to bring to the table and we bring our sin to the table. And that makes us add things into the conversation that aren't really there.
Mm-hmm.
And so, anyway, I think this is important to your point about, like, oh, these are the things that only women can do. I heard somebody say years ago, a leadership principle, he said, he was talking to leaders, and he said, hey, leaders, only do what only you can do. And I've held on to that in a lot of different ways and kind of growing in that. And I love that, because what I think that comment does is it captures the unique strengths of any given individual. And it doesn't say, hey, leader, here's the only things you can do.
Mm-hmm.
He's saying, there's certain things that only you can do. And if you don't do them, nobody else does them, but they need to be done. So among the other things you do, make sure you're also doing, and especially doing, the things that only you can do.
Mm-hmm.
Not the only things you can do, but the things that only you can do. And that was the goal, if this makes sense. And those two things is saying, these aren't the only things women can do. These aren't the only things a woman can do. These are just things that God has hardwired into women. And among all of the amazing things women do in general, or a woman does as a woman and just as a person, like in the midst of it all, like, let's just recognize and celebrate that these are two things that women do in a unique way as a gift from God to the rest of all of creation. Can we just all be really thankful for that right now?
Mm-hmm. And you were like specifically speaking about looking at those Genesis stories, like,
yeah,
these are the two promises maybe that women represent,
mm-hmm.
Which I thought was great.
Yeah.
And is worth listening to. If you'd missed the message, it's worth going back. I mean, it's worth going back always, but it was worth going back just to hear like the synopsis you gave on the accounts.
Mm.
And I think it's interesting to note that right now
a lot of society seems to be like the new thing is to raise your child genderless.
Yeah.
Like not only to decorate their room in a gender neutral style, which seems safe because girl, boy, you can use the same stuff. But now it's like actually moved into not raising them as a boy or girl and having people determine it, and which is moving away from the whole thing. But I feel like it's an important question of why is gender important? Like, why is it different that we're distinctly different?
Yeah.
Like, why is it special? Why is it needed that we're different?
Yeah.
Do you have an answer for that?
I mean, I have a beginning of an answer. I think that it matters because apparently it matters to God.
Right.
That in the beginning he made two different genders. He made male and he made female. Mm-hmm. And again, I think what's really important is we have to, in all of these conversations, all these cultural conversations, we have to recognize that the focus of the conversation is not culture. The focus of the conversation is not women. It's not men. It's not you. It's not me. It's not our opinions. It's none of that. The macro always has to be God and his purposes and plans for the earth. Everything is ultimately about his glory. So when you start from there and under that, I think that really starts to set the stage that, oh, okay, God didn't make me so that I could be all about me.
Right.
God made me for his glory. Mm-hmm. So that means that's what that's the perspective I need to bring to any different conversation. So there's two genders because God said that's the way he's going to do it. Mm-hmm. And he said, we're going to make man in our image and we're going to do it with male and female. And so those are two different genders with a whole lot of similarities and a whole lot of crossover, but there are some unique things that each can bring to the table. And those aren't things to get around. Those aren't things to get offended about. Those are things to celebrate about each other. Like if I'm getting mad, if as a man, I got offended at those two points I make on the message, like that's my loss.
Mm-hmm.
If I want to live my life wishing I was everything to everybody, like, I guess that's my prerogative and I can try to run that race, but I'm going to be really worn out. And I think that there's a whole lot more freedom in realizing like, I'm not perfect. I'm not everything to everybody. There's things I don't bring to the table, but there's other people that do bring those things to the table. So instead of me getting mad and offended and wondering if I'm better or worse than them, why don't we just do it together and understand that God gave male and female together the same direction and mission from the very beginning to do together.
Yeah.
Which is multiply, be fruitful, subdue the earth, spread the glory of God.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, cool. So that's what we're here to do is spread the glory of God together.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm spending time trying to decide who's better and who's worse, I'm just off base from the get-go.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of a waste of time.
Yeah. No, and it makes me think of when, I think it's Isaiah where he talks about like, it's basically God speaking and he's saying, like, you're the clay, I'm the potter. Why would the clay turn around and be like, what are you making with me?
Mm.
And just saying, like, if God is the creator, it makes sense then that he could make something in divine wisdom and limit it.
Yeah.
Like I love how in the Bible it talks about how he set the limit for the seas. And then how in Psalm 16, the boundary lines to me have fallen in pleasant places. Like, if we could have hearts big enough to believe that there are boundaries, even to our gender, boundaries to male and female, but they're good boundaries. Like, it's a beautiful inheritance.
Right.
I feel like it.
Yeah, and the things that are different about each other, we should celebrate and empower and need in one another. And so, like, something else I think that was worth saying, though, is that, you know, I just said it's a waste of time to figure out who's better and who's worse. Kind of on the other side of that, there's a lot of questions that people carry in their lives of what's my value and what's my worth.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not a waste of time because that comes from never being told the answer to those questions or having that stolen from you in different painful experiences or whatever. So that's more coming from the design of God is not to focus on who's better and who's worse. The reality is we live in a sinful, broken world where sinful and broken people have taken that value and some of these answers and all of these things, and they've demeaned some of these God-given things so that, you know, like there's a lot of women walking around that have been told that they're less than a man, whether it was in church or not.
Right.
So the question, am I less than a man? That's not a waste of time to talk about, you know, because that God wants to speak to that and say no.
Yeah.
But then the conversation doesn't have to turn into, okay, who's better, man or woman? So the point of the conversation isn't to define who's better, the point of the conversation is to put value on the person from God, right, from the get-go. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
So that, I think that's, again, that's why it gets complicated, is because God had a design, but we're living in a world and we're living lives and we've all sinned and we're living in a world full of sin where our norm is a broken design. Mm-hmm. So that it seems so often that the answer is, well, let's get rid of the differences.
Right.
Because then there's nothing to be heard about. Mm-hmm. And it sort of sounds good on the surface, but it doesn't work because it's still against the original design. So the answer isn't we need to get rid of gender. The answer is we need to get rid of sin.
Yeah. And we need to get God's heart for gender.
Right.
I think one of the things we talked about was sometimes, you know, even as a little girl reading the Bible, it can become patriarchal, you know, and it is like it's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And it's like, what about Sarah and Rebecca? And, but when you look at the Bible, I think the life of Jesus answers a lot of, at least my own personal, like, struggle with, like, oh, were you initiating with women? Not only that, but then when I really read the Old Testament, it becomes really apparent that God was initiating with women just as much as he was initiating with men.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, if the requirement is to love God and to love our neighbor, like, women are set up to obey in the same, you know what I mean? The same capacity that a man would. There's nothing holding them back.
Yeah.
From those things.
Yeah, and I think if you start from that Genesis 1 and 2 perspective and see that God has always been talking to humanity and talking to both, and his heart has always been the same exact heart, mission, call for both, then when it says he talked to this guy or he's the God of this guy, like, then clearly the heart's both. Like, where it starts to expand into is like, okay, we can't get sidetracked every time it says he's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Just because he didn't list every other human on earth, does that mean he's that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob were more important than every other person on the planet? It's like, not even just women, what about all the other people? And it's like, okay,
yeah,
all right, like, let's just slow it down a little bit. And, like, again, I think that's where we can come to God and come to the Bible with our guard up, which I think reveals a lot about us. Like, I know for me, and I know that so many of my questions at times, like, the truth is, I'll come to the Bible with an attitude of, like, what's God going to tell me I can't do or can't be? And so that's how I read the lens. But I've learned I get so much more revelation from the Bible and from God when I come in with my guard down and trust that he's actually really awesome and really good, and that he does love me, and I don't understand everything. But, like, hey, whatever he's going to say is good. And when I come to the Bible with my guard down, that's where the revelation of God really flows, and that's where I really start to get to know him. Because when I come with my guard up, ultimately, I'm just there. It's about me.
Yeah.
When I come with my guard down, I'm free to just be like, Lord, I'm whatever you want to say. Like, I just want you.
So we launched a couple of Instagram questions about the specific message. And some of the questions, or we asked people to ask questions.
Yeah.
And some of them revolved around the passages in the New Testament that are specifically Paul speaking about women being silent in the church, or whatever they were. And reconciling those with the message you spoke. And you were talking to me about how that actually brought you to this place of, like, well, it all depends on how we, like, read our Bible. Like, do we know how to read our Bible?
Yeah.
Not against anyone that would, like, those are, it's hard. This is, it feels hard, at least to me, to reconcile some of those things. So can you just take me into, like, what you were meaning when you said that?
Yeah, so I think, like you said, we didn't, and I said at the beginning of the message, we didn't have a roles conversation or a who can do what conversation, because those are kind of walls of the house, and we needed to talk about the foundation of it. And so I think the walls conversation still needs to happen at some level. It's definitely happening, and a lot of people have those types of, a lot of questions, specifically about two different little chunks of verses in the New Testament about, you know, saying women should be quiet and do these sort of things in two different places. And that's grounds for a lot of different questions and conversations that a lot of people have. And I think those verses weren't specifically referenced in the questions that we got, but I'm assuming that's what these people are talking about. And I think it's a fair question. But, you know, the questions even were, you know, when we word the question of how do we reconcile the message that I gave with what Paul says in the New Testament, I think that there's different questions there other than just that original question. So I think number one is, I don't think that there's any need. We don't need to reconcile them to one another, because I think we need to, in approaching the Bible, we need to understand it's one big story. Mm-hmm. It's God. It's the same God, beginning to end, revealing himself to all of creation so that people can know him and we can be a part of his purposes in the earth. And so the same God who created everything in Genesis 1 and 2 is the same God who we believe spoke the whole rest of the Bible and inspired the rest of the Bible. Then I think it also comes into questions about, okay, well, what about what God did in Genesis 1 versus what Paul said in these other verses? And it's like, okay, I think that the foundational, you know, is this the word of God or is these Paul's words? And it's sort of like both, you know, but I think primarily we have to understand that, okay, believe that this all these words are God breathed and God inspired. So God is revealing himself to his people through every word in this book. And so I think contextually, sometimes maybe that's a good word, maybe it's not, but okay, yeah, Paul said, I this, and okay, did God say, I said that? Well, Paul had that conversation, so I guess it's Paul's words, but it's God speaking to us, so all the words are useful for teaching and useful for correcting and all of these sort of things. So God is still speaking in whether it's 1st or 2nd Timothy, those verses, and I don't even remember what the other verses are off the top of my head. God is speaking in there. And then there's how do we read the Bible, which is the Bible interprets the Bible. Mm-hmm. And we don't take one sentence out of the whole Bible and build a theology or a practice for anything. We look at the whole thing and say, what is God's message to us on any given topic or any given anything? What's the message that he's saying overall? How does it line up with his overall general purposes and plans? And so from the get-go, I think God sets the context that men and women are different. Men and women are equal, and both men and women are called to be a part of his purposes and his glory in the earth. Mm-hmm. And then the rest of the Bible is the unfolding of that as God reconciles a broken humanity and world to himself. And so that's why it's messy, not because God's messy, but because sin is messy. Mm-hmm. And so we have to approach the whole thing, I think, with the whole picture and context that God is clearly not sexist. The Bible is not sexist. God is trying to bring people to himself to manifest what he originally planned mm-hmm. for us. So I think that's how we have to start. Mm-hmm. And I know it's kind of a big, long answer.
No, but, it's good.
But it's helpful, because what I'm trying to say is that the two chunks of verses that people have questions about in the New Testament are not at all the only things written about what God thinks about women, mm-hmm. you know? And so women are in the whole Bible, and from the very beginning to the end, they're all always a part of the plan. And so we have to read it inside of that context. And so you can start dissecting even those specific things and have the conversation about roles in church. But even that gets interesting.
So interesting.
Because we...
And polarizing. You know, especially these verses, we need to approach it knowing that, like, churches have split over this. There
totally.
Are parties. There's egalitarian. There's complementarian. I always get them confused.
If I know which one's which.
Right. But saying, like, okay, so this is... We believe what God is... What is God saying to Antioch? Mm-hmm. What has God put on your heart as, like, the pioneer of whatever we're doing here?
Right.
I thought one thing that you specifically said was interesting was that church isn't, that we run church as an organization sometimes, but that God's heart for like the church.
Right.
Will you go into that?
Yeah. So yeah, I think that adds the complication to how we look at it, because even again, anytime there's a difference or even a limitation, if there's something a woman does better than a man or a man does better than a woman, we look at that as a devaluing reality of like, how do we get around that? How do we explain that? How do we reconcile that? And it's like, what if it's nothing to reconcile? It just is something to celebrate, actually, mm-hmm. you know? So, sorry, I just got sidetracked for a second, but when church and the organization, that's what you asked about. Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. In our mindset, when we think of church, we think of a 501c3 organization that has paid staff roles and positions of influence and all of these sorts of things. And so people begin asking, can women hold positions of authority? Can women preach? Can women be this or can women be that? And we're asking all of those questions in the context of, well, what does God say about how we set up our organization? And the reality is that is a few levels down the priorities of anything that God lined out in the Bible. God doesn't talk about the church as a government organization that has these roles. I mean, there's the apostles and references about how they got paid and, you know, all that kind of stuff. But like, God does not line out, here's how you set up your 501c3 and who's allowed to do what. Mm-hmm. God's vision for his people and his church is always a family. It's never been an organization. So the language that God uses for church and his people is all family language and no organization language, really. Mm-hmm. So we have to change the whole perspective of what we're even saying and realize that if we were to sit down right here with God and say, can women hold positions of authority? We're asking from a completely different angle than he's asking. And not that it doesn't matter. I think it matters how we build the organization and we steward it well and all, you know, blah, 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 all those sorts of things. But like, again, that's maybe walls. And God wants to talk about the foundation of like, the organization doesn't matter if there's no family,
mm-hmm.
both individual families, but then also is it itself, is our church, is Antioch as a people, are we family? And that's why we say we want to be family. Like it's not a cliche of like, oh, we just want to like each other. It's like, no, let's be the family of God, because that's the language that he has for his people. And mm-hmm. so we have to start thinking through that context.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Does that make enough sense? What follow-up questions you have?
I still feel like, I feel like because these issues are argued about in other churches and people are constantly asking, like, is a woman allowed to speak? And mm-hmm. obviously, like, you've allowed me to speak and Heather to speak.
Right, totally.
And so I think there's maybe a personal question within our family of Antioch. Mm. Of like, how are we, what are we just going to say? Not like, what camp are we in? So I know, so I can tell my friends and then I can tell them that they're wrong.
100%.
Because that's not what I want to do. And every time I speak, I'm like, wow, this is such a privilege. I feel like to be under someone who is okay with me exercising this gift that I have. But it's not, I would not walk into another church and sit there and be like, you really need to let me on your stage. I can't believe you're so sexist. Like if someone said, I actually interpret it this way, and I don't feel like you're supposed to speak. I feel like I would want my heart to like be like, that's great.
Totally.
You know?
Yeah, because I think that even reflects on a much bigger issue of why do you need to speak so bad?
Yeah.
Not because you're a woman, because I'm just saying why do we walk into a church and say, they better let me do X, Y, Z thing anyways? Like,
that's
the whole.
Hard. I mean, it's hard when you've
And I understand, like, well, I feel called to do this and all these kind of things. And it's like, okay, yes, but God always prioritizes love and character over gifting.
Totally.
So like my gifts, whatever they are, don't give me a right to do anything.
Mm-hmm.
Like God cares about character and do I love Jesus and love people? He didn't call me because I can do all this kind of like, or anybody, because you can do this, that, or the other thing. Like God can use anybody to do whatever the heck he wants to do. He doesn't need my gifting.
Right.
My gifting is a gift and it's a manifestation of God for the common good. But if I don't manifest it for the common good, he's allowed to shut that down, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So there's that.
Right. No. And I think it's
as far as a perspective,
no,
you know,
it's
like,
good.
Well, and I should be able to do.
Right. And it's like, not humility. And I think as a woman thinking about this, I'm like, wow, Lord, I would rather like, be humble in heart like you were, like when Jesus says, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden.
Right.
And he says, for I am humble and gentle at
heart.
And if that is if my perspective is not like, hey, as a woman, what I can and can't do and how can I push the boundaries? And it's like, I want to be humble and gentle at heart
100%.
Because you are. And I want you to acknowledge that. And it seems to me that throughout the Bible, he's a rewarder of those who seek him.
100%.
Not just like the man who seeks him.
No, totally. And I mean, what's more common in the Bible? God calling his people to humbly love him and humbly love other people, or stand up on a stage with a microphone on a Sunday morning in a building and preach.
Right.
It's like, it matters, but like there's other stuff that matters more, you know? And so that we have to get to first.
Mm-hmm.
I don't let you don't preach because you're a woman. You don't preach because you preach because you're gifted at it. Our body needs it. You're great at it. We all get better because you do it. And it's like, we want God.
Right. To speak.
And so the gifts of God, like they're not gender based.
Yeah.
And so, we can have all of these different conversations of the nuances of why this and why that. But again, I think there's so many bigger foundational things that really matter a whole lot more.
I heard someone say about another issue, but they were like, this is not the hill you want to die on. And it seems like there are definitely abuses in sex, in gender, in the sexes going against one another. And so it's like, yes, as the church, we want to be a model of how to eliminate the abuse.
Right.
But we also want to be a model of saying, like, there are differences. We want to be able to live with the tension.
Right.
and submit yes. to one another. And how do we do that well? Basically?
Totally. And I think that goes back to Genesis 1 and 2, mm-hmm. is that when God created male and female, it was together, unified in their call. They need one another. They need one another to do the only things that only the other can do. Mm-hmm. You know, like be fruitful, multiply. One side can only do different sides of that equation. Like, yeah. I mean, just at the most basic level, but true. There's so much more. And then Genesis 3, the fall, sin, and the result of sin is now enmity between the two. Mm-hmm. And so, again, the answer isn't make men and women the same, get rid of differences, say that everybody's the same. Everybody's the same value, mm-hmm. but everybody's not the same. Mm-hmm. You know, like, I'm different than every other human being on the planet. We are not the same. Mm-hmm. We are of the same value before God, but we're not the same. There are things that I can do in a way that I can do it that nobody else has ever been able to do it. Mm-hmm. And like, that's amazing. And same for you. And like, that doesn't make either one of us better than the other. It makes us both need each other. And I need, like, we need each other. Mm-hmm. And that's the beauty of the church,
yeah.
is that nobody's got it all together. And I just think there's so much power to be unlocked to preach the gospel to the world if we can get past this cultural concept of, like, I have to be better than everybody else. Where's my spot? I have to do my thing. This whole deal of just like, oh my gosh, like, I get it. And yes, like, our gifts matter and our personality matter. All those things are so big, but they only make sense and fall into line when we're prioritizing loving Jesus and loving each other. Like, mm-hmm. Jesus died on a cross for us. Mm-hmm. Like, Jesus, God.
Yeah.
I mean, that's like the whole thing, you yeah. know?
And like, you can have as much of him as you want.
Yeah.
You know, whoever is hungry, like, he's going to fill. He's right. not asking.
And it goes into like, okay, you can speak in tongues, you can give everything away, but if you don't have love, like, mm-hmm. so what? Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, you can preach your guts out, but if you don't love people, like, it doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. It does not matter at all. You can have whatever position of authority you want. You can have whatever job in a church organization. You can be empowered to do anything you want in the whole world. But if you don't love Jesus and love people, if you're not leveraging that thing to love Jesus and love people, then it doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm. I think one thing I like appreciate about you is not that you oversimplify things, but you tend to simplify what can feel very complicated and sticky. And that is, like, your bent. And so I'm, like, happily following in that. And then I also think that there are people who, if this is a hang-up issue mm-hmm. for them, especially, like, a woman preaching and those sorts of things, I feel like in the past your heart has been, like, that is okay. That you're, like, you're not going to mm-hmm. argue someone into whatever you think.
Right.
And it's more, like, the blessing of, like, find somewhere where your heart doesn't mm-hmm. get offended every 3 weeks when you
totally.
Have someone else speak.
Yeah. Know? Yeah, yeah. I mean, we've had that conversation with people before mm-hmm. who are like, this is a big thing for me. And it's like, that's totally okay. Like, you don't owe me it not being a big thing to you. Like, you don't owe me you having a certain conclusion or agreeing with me or whatever, but here's how we're doing it. And so if you want to jump on board with us in this house and yeah. all this stuff, awesome, let's do it. If this isn't the lane, then awesome, love you. Mm-hmm. Run with some other people, because again, the point isn't, do you agree with me mm-hmm. or do you like when so-and-so preaches or whatever? The point is we all want to run after Jesus. And like mm-hmm. you said, this isn't a hill that I want to die on and burn bridges and relationship over and all that kind of stuff. So it's like, man, if it's just better for you to go somewhere else that you can just land on more comfortably for this issue, and that's what ultimately frees you up to run your lane and do all that. So, okay, awesome. Go do it. Mm-hmm. You know, like that, because that's really more important than this issue anyways, mm-hmm. is like all of us running in what God's called us to do. And so
yeah.
let's throw off some of the stuff that doesn't matter. And if that means we don't run as closely together as some other people, then it's like, okay, we still love you. And
yeah.
so go, you know, go do your thing somewhere else. And there's no hard feelings, because it's not the point.
Right. I loved that. I feel like listening to the message, just like with things that you perceive as cultural wounds or like women wounds, like things that I'm like, oh, I'm supposed to be sensitive to this because I'm a woman. I felt like one of the most healing things, And I've heard it spoken about, I think, like, one other time was the word Ezer. I think you said Ezer. I'm not sure how we pronounce it. Whatever.
I was probably right.
You probably were. Duh. But in Genesis, where God says, I'm going to make you a helpmate suitable, and it's this word. And, like, there are just certain things that have, you know, as you talked about, the lens you approach the Bible with, like, me as a little girl approaching the Bible and recognizing I'm not a man. I don't think it was like a real thought, but it was like a thought. Like, it definitely influenced things of like, am I allowed? Like, none of his disciples were women. And then when I really think about that, I'm like, there actually were some that followed him, but it would probably be awkward if there was a woman who was like sleeping with all of them in the middle of the garden. Like, that would be culturally strange. And I think he did things purposefully that wouldn't offend a bunch of people and send a bunch of red flags. Like, I'm sure
that's
he
such
lived.
A sensible way to think about that.
Yeah. But I'm like, I'm sure he wished Mary Magdalene was there instead of Peter or whatever.
She probably was there a lot more than we think she was.
I mean, she was there first to the tomb.
Exactly.
But when I approach the Bible, when I like what, some of the healing things, things that have healed my like approach to God, is looking through contextually, looking at the Hebrews like 11 Hall of Faith. Like, there are a lot of women and a lot of men.
Yeah.
But there are a lot of women.
Totally.
That he decided were worth mentioning.
Totally.
You know, you and I talked about, there's a story where Sarah sends out Hagar, basically the woman she gave Abraham to sleep with,
right,
who like should not have value in God's eyes.
Right.
Sent her out to the wilderness with her son. God appears twice to her, and she has this revelation of his character and is the first one to call him El Roy, the God who sees.
Yeah.
And I was like, wow, that's a big.
Totally.
She's getting a theological revelation on God, and she's a woman.
And there's a lot of women throughout Acts and the letters of the New Testament, of a lot of women in the early church, a lot of women leaders, prophetesses, the whole thing.
Yeah,
in fact, this is the whole Paul thing. Like, Paul celebrates a lot of different women.
Totally, a lot of women.
And there's different things that even people pull out of, like, well, Paul said this and that, and it's like the limitations of the women, like, right after he says something to men, too.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's, he wouldn't.
It wasn't meant to be.
It wasn't all the same, you know?
But not even to argue those things. It was more just those things healed my heart, and also this word that you brought up. Will you, like, just remind us what that word was and what it meant.
How do we pronounce it again?
I don't remember. Yeah. You said Ezer. I said Ezer.
Ezer? Is that what I said? Well, anyways, I think it's a word that's used, what was it? It was 21 times in the Old Testament, twice there in Genesis 2, talking about God creating woman. The other 19 times it's used about God helping his people.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a word he uses about himself as providing the only help that he can provide in a situation that's desperately needed by his people.
Mm-hmm. It's beautiful. And I think, like, it's worth recognizing for me, like, being married, like, I love that Chad is a man, and I love the things that make him a man.
Mm-hmm.
He does certain things, and not even to stereotype what men and women do, but I imagine in every married couple there are things that they do.
Right.
And if you're, like, a single woman, there are things that you need a man to do.
Right.
You know, to, like...
And if you're a single man, there's things you need a woman to
definitely.
Do.
You and your, like, laundry. But just thinking, like, the healing message is really that, like, we need each other.
Totally.
Both genders need each
and
other.
And I think the other thing that's really huge that I tried to go into in the message is, like, what's with this demeaning view of help anyways?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no,
like,
I thought that was
first of all, that. Like, not saying, I'm not making the point, I'm not saying why it's right that women's only existence is to help men. That's not what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I'm zooming out from that and saying, like, where did we get that perspective that help is weak anyways? Like, isn't the point of help the fact that you need somebody stronger than you right now?
Mm-hmm. Totally.
And how did we get so skewed to the point where, like, we see helpers as weak and we see that as a weak, like.
That's definitely not it.
So, because we don't think that when we ask God for help.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we don't need God's help because he's weak.
Right, totally. And I think, like, as we even started talking about this message, you know, weeks ago, months ago, one of the things that you kept saying was, why do we need to talk about this? Like, it feels like it should already be known that women have worth and value. But I think when we look at culture, there are certain things that are being asked. And the big question is women fighting for their worth, because obviously it's been taken in certain ways and places. And how do we, like, not partner with the enemy who, it literally says, like, there will be enmity between her and him, between her and Satan.
Yeah.
And if you look at centuries, it seems like the agenda of the enemy has been to silence and squash women from a lot of things.
Totally.
But how healthy of a church could we be if we allowed both to have voice and both to have.
Yeah. And I think that's been part of a lot of what, you know, the devil has done. But I think it's also a lot of what men have done.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's no getting around that. Like, it's not just the devil who's done it. It's been a lot of men have really jacked this whole thing up.
Yeah.
And so I don't know, I think we have to make sure we're underscoring this and saying, you know, women who are having the question, where do I fit in this whole thing? Because I feel like I'm in a system or whatever that tells me that I'm secondary. That's not automatically just some selfish thing. And it's like, right. Oh, don't worry about it. You're just being selfish and want to do your gift. Like, I don't want that to get lost in what we were talking about earlier. That question is legitimate because men have so sinned in what I think is such a huge part of the man's calling, which is to, I think that there's an element of man from the beginning that God was saying, I'm putting you in an environment to lift everything else up. Mm-hmm. And instead of doing that, men have pushed women down and created so much space for a question that should never be asked.
Yeah,
and so when women are asking that question, I'm not saying that it's this automatic selfish thing. I'm saying that the major reason we're having the whole conversation is not because women need to get over and understand God loves them and all that kind of stuff. It's because I think men aren't doing their part of the puzzle either, which is creating an environment where it's like, I think that the most manly thing a man can do is also the most servant hearted thing a Christian can do. But it's like, okay, everybody just stand on me.
Yeah.
Like I only exist to make an environment where you can be everything God has called you to be. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that, and, you know, that's a whole other conversation, but I think that that's part of what's so masculine and what God was calling Adam to do in making order out of everything. Was like, create everything to be everything it's supposed to be, like push, serve, create environments. And he doesn't do that for Eve. Instead, he turns and he blames her. And there's so many different dynamics in the middle of it where I don't think Adam did his job. And I think that men have done the opposite of what we're called to do so often. And so many of the times women are asking the question, do I have any value? It's because men have stepped up time and time again to say, no, you don't. You know what I'm saying? It's like, come on.
I think what you pointed this out when Adam, he names everything.
Yeah.
And you were saying in the message, like, he was seeing that there was no one suitable for him. But there also is something interesting about he, like, named Eve. And what you're just saying, like, if a male's role, like, what if it is to give worth and value, like a father wound? Like, that's why a lot of people have father wounds, is no one told them the identity piece.
No, I mean, I think there's a ton there. I think there's a ton there. Like, I was just thinking, this is just I don't know, are we almost done?
We're almost done, but yeah, give me your last
thought. I don't know if we should go into this then.
Well, go ahead.
Okay,
go ahead.
Just a thought that God tells Adam not to eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil before he made Eve.
I know.
And so the fact that Adam never provided, Adam was passive. And that created the room that should have never existed. And I'm not saying Eve's so weak she couldn't resist. It's none of that garbage. I'm just saying.
Chad has this, like, I'm saying, free from passivity that Antioch Waco gave out one time.
No, I mean, I think passivity in men is the origin of most of a lot of why a lot of these things are really tricky. It's because men of God haven't stepped up to provide safe environments for everybody to be everything that they're called to be. And so therefore there's room for the devil to come in where he shouldn't. And there's room for a lot of questions to be asked that shouldn't have to be asked.
I think it's worth saying too, I believe it is your intention to do a equal message. So we've done the woman and to at some point to do the man thing.
Steve Zanocco's coming on Father's Day.
Cause I think it's worth it to say, like, okay, so we've talked about women. How do we be an environment that really celebrates both, though?
Totally.
And recognizes their difference. So people can look forward to that on Father's Day.
Number one, men cannot be so passive and not be so insecure that they feel like they got to push people down to make them great. So
we got great men in this church.
We
and
do
great
have great
women
in this church and great women in this church. We got great people in this church. This is awesome.
So I hope that even hearing this podcast for people who are listening, that it brings clarity. It might create more questions, but even in those questions, the encouragement is to spend time with the Lord and then ask clarifying questions.
Totally.
But for all
I think
of
always,
us.
Always start questioning your own perspective and saying, what assumptions am I making? What am I bringing to the table? Not then make you sinner and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
It's just being just recognizing, saying, okay, what am I bringing to the table? What guard am I coming up to God with? Where can I just put the walls down and say, okay, God, I just want to hear, like, I want to hear what you have to say.
Totally. It's good. All right. Thanks for listening, guys. And you can check in soon with another podcast. See you later.